Dallas, I wonder if we're not surprised the fact that we're migrating from TV to internet, but perhaps what's surprising is the rate of change at which TV advertising is really falling off a cliff.
I think what we're seeing is just the maturation of television advertising, as it's now, the dollars are now finally following the consumer eyeballs as they migrate away from linear television to really streaming television. What we know today is that 6 out of 10 US adults stream, and they stream a lot. The average streamer watches twice as much streaming content as they do linear television content. And that doesn't even take into account the 42% of US adults that say they either are gonna cut the cord or have already. If you just look at the holiday shopping season we're in right now, which is a marketer's target-rich environment, fully a third of consumers say they'll watch zero live television during the holiday season. So the real challenge for marketers who still spend 95% of their TV budgets in these linear television channels is beginning to become very aware as those dollars are now moving to where the streamers are going. And there's going to be some winners and losers.
Dallas, that is a fascinating statistic to me. You are going to watch zero ads of live TV, 0 hours of live TV this holiday season. Is that a new statistic?
It is. It's a new survey that came out from the Harris poll researching consumers that said that fully a third will watch zero live television. The races to watch that I think are really interesting, there are 3 ad races to watch here, I think, as we're trying to sum up who's going to be a winner here in the $75 billion ad race. You have the platform race, the content race, and the data race. On the platform side, I think clearly Roku is in the pole position to the number one smart TV operating system in the world. Hundreds of apps utilize the Roku platform to reach consumers, and Roku sells those ads for those apps. Their advertising business is up 80% year over year. On the content side, you see a couple platforms like Hulu, which is owned by Disney, and Pluto TV, which is owned by Viacom, that have really leaned into the ad-supported model. A majority of consumers report preferring an ad-supported model versus kind of the Netflix subscription-based model, which is why you see Hulu, for example, 70% of their users are ad-supported. The last one, which I think is kind of the most interesting, gets the least amount of attention, and that's the data race that we're seeing unfold. Television advertising today is still largely bought and sold the way we've been doing it for 30 years, off of a few thousand set-top boxes on Nielsen that are trying to extrapolate the behaviors of 300 million Americans across the most fragmented media environment we've ever seen. And marketers are saying that doesn't work. So you've begun seeing companies like Samba TV, for example. Samba TV is a company that has their software on most television manufacturers' devices. They're in 25 million televisions across the world. It's able to provide real-time data for marketers, a breadth and depth that's never before been available, that's driving higher ROI for those marketers. So for no other reason, we're going to see ad dollars continue to migrate to streaming and to smart connected devices simply because they work better.
Dallas, I want to break down 3 of those that you just touched on, one of which is Roku. If you take a look at a chart that I'm showing here inside my terminal, it is the stock of Roku and then the average analyst price target. The trend is up, but frankly, it has been a volatile story as investors really try to figure out what streaming wars mean for Roku. Do you believe that you cannot launch a streaming platform unless you also do it with Roku?
I think Roku is the undoubted winner here in the streaming wars as we think about what happens in the next couple of months and what's already happened in the last few months. If you just look at Disney Plus, for example, Disney was seeing about 1 million downloads every single day of Disney Plus. During that same time frame, Roku downloads were up 50%. So people were actually going to get the Roku operating system so they could then access Disney Plus. So they are uniquely positioned in the ecosystem today to benefit from the $8 to $10 billion in content that's going to be spent because you need to watch it on a platform. Disney doesn't have a platform that you can watch it on, neither does Netflix. You're going to be going to your Roku device. If you've gone to a big box retailer, you've seen the Roku television. It's the number one TV operating system in the world. You can buy a 55-inch smart 4K TV for $200. They're really in a great position in the market today.
You also talk about some of the winners from this, namely Hulu, which makes me wonder, is it a price or content? Do I like Hulu because it's $4, $5, $6 a month and not $15 a month? Or is it a content story?
Well, I think Hulu, what they've done well is they're having their cake and they're eating it too. They're offering the subscriber, they're offering the user either the subscription model that has no ads or the ad-based model. So the user is actually getting to pick and choose what they want. What we've seen from polling is that about 58% of US consumers prefer an ad-supported model that gets them somewhere around $5 or $6 a month, and about 40% prefer a subscription-based model. The challenge here, we didn't talk about the losers, but I think the real challenge here is gonna be for Netflix. I've said on this program before that I absolutely believe Netflix is gonna have to introduce an advertising-supported model They've reached a saturation point in the United States with subscribers. They can't raise their price any higher with Disney undercutting them at less than half the price. So I think what Hulu's done very smartly is they've read the market. They understand there's an appetite for both, and they've offered both.